Hello, and welcome back to a new episode of Time for You, where you get to just unplug from your daily life and listen in. Maybe you're doing your laundry. A lot of times I love to listen to podcasts while I'm folding clothes and putting the
Me
wash
too.
in. So if you're doing that, awesome. Otherwise, so glad to see you. My name is Shailia Stevens, and this is my beautiful colleague, Leah Vanley.
Hey.
So we're continuing on our little experiment of real talk today, where we just kind of talk about our lives and where we are, like just kind of with the way Leah and I would talk to each other if you weren't here in a way. And so Leah, the thing I want to talk about today is a kind of a heavy topic, but I'm not scared of heavy topics, and I know you're not scared of heavy topics.
No.
And it's kind of about between hope and life and death, is the topic that I thought we could jam on today. So you know me for quite a long time, and you know that I have kind of some heavy experiences with the topic of death. I had a period of time between 2004 and 2007, where I lost a lot of people in my family. My mother died of a heart attack. I was 29 years old. She was 52 back in 2004. 2 days before her, my aunt, one of my favorite aunts, she passed away just suddenly of hepatitis C. Nobody saw it coming. My mom was in a coma while when that happened. My uncle had died a few weeks before that, on my mom's side. But it was like then that my family was starting to die off. My brother died 3 years later, as a soldier in Afghanistan, sort of like as a chain effect. He had been with my mom, when she had had her heart attack, and she thought she was having an asthma attack, and he was going to try to drive her to the hospital, and she had passed out. Somehow he got her in the car, and he couldn't drive her stick shift, and he was stuck in her driveway, and she didn't, make it. It was a light heart attack, and so he always had this feeling that he could have saved her. And out of the utter guilt that he felt, and he told us, he's like, "I'm gonna go into the military." He was already done with college. He said, "I'm gonna go to the front and get killed, and then I'll have my, what I deserve, because I couldn't help mom." And he didn't really want that. I think at the end of the day, it ended up happening, right? And all of my grandparents died within that period. What I really thought is, I know about death. I've done the grief thing, right? I know how to get through a situation like that. I have done it many, many, many times. And I also thought, I know the incredible gifts that are in the death of a really close loved one. Like I had gone through all the years of realizing that those people who leave this earth, they stay with you in such a different way than they could ever be with you when they're here. It's like they're infused with you. All the best things about them continue on with you in your life. And so, I felt like I could really see all the blessings that death brings, like the appreciation we get from being the ones who are still alive, like taking the extra breaths for the people who can't, like all the stuff, all the spiritual growth that happens when you are faced with situations like that. Like I thought, I've got this down. And I'm kind of entering into a new era of my life in a way. I'll be turning 50 in next year in 2024. I'm a 74 child. Like, yoo-hoo, all the 74 people out there. It's one of my favorite years. And, I I'm being confronted at the moment with a different kind of dying, if you will. So recently, my father-in-law got diagnosed with cancer of the bladder that had spread to his lungs. He started chemotherapy. My father is right now going through like dialysis 3 times a week. His liver isn't functioning, that kind of thing. So elderly people moving into sort of, I'm just going to say end stage mm-hmm. of life. Like mm-hmm. Who knows how long they both will still be with us. I hope for as long as they possibly want to. But then also recently, Leah, you know about my situation. I have 2 beautiful dogs mm-hmm. and, they're both 9 years old. And a couple of weeks ago, and I think we talked about it on the podcast where Duke was still in the hospital. Mm-hmm. My little Dalmatian almost, died, and he had, it turns out, this like super rare autoimmune condition that is on the literature books only 3 times in all of veterinary history. It's this very strange thing. And what I started to feel, or where, let's say, how this new phase feels like to me, I'll just try to explain it. I don't know if I can, but it's like, what I experienced before was everybody who got sick died. Or in my brother's case, the bomb went off, the convoy exploded, he was gone. Like people mm-hmm. just were kind of suddenly not there anymore. And this time, what mm-hmm. I'm kind of faced with is this lingering illness, mysterious, unknown, and it feels a lot different than before. Like this kind of situation with people and with animals mm-hmm. where I really kind of made the assumption I'm not supposed to have hope. Like when I heard the diagnosis of Heiko's father or mm-hmm. when the dog was in the clinic, I really noticed I had sort of trained myself in a way to not expect the best. It was just kind of like this realistic kind of thing where just brace yourself. They're probably going to die. That's what happens in a situation like this. And where I started to see, wait a minute, is that a good way of being in this situation right mm-hmm. now, this time? And I had a few sort of, let's say, milestone moments. And I'm just going to use mm-hmm. the example with Duke because that week was so intense where like we were calling the clinic every day and they were basically saying to us, he's not getting better. He's mm-hmm. brace yourself, you know, for the worst. And I got a call, or not a call, I got a WhatsApp message. So a friend of mine, her daughters, they love me to death. They call me Mama Shailia. They say that I'm their second mother, right? And they heard about Duke, and one is 14 and one is 18. And the 14-year-old, she wrote me a message, and it was something to the effect of, Mama Shailian, don't worry. Oh, it's gonna make me cry, but I just talk about it. She was like, Duke's gonna get through this. She was like, he's a warrior dog. She's like, I want to tell you about a couple weeks ago, my cat Chili got sick, and everybody thought he was gonna die. And she said to me, he didn't die. He made it through, and Duke is going to do exactly that. And she was so positive and so hopeful and so clear in her feeling that he's going to make it. And I thought, you know, that's so sweet. She's 14. And then her sister made me a message. It was it was an audio message, and she's Austrian. And so it was in an Austrian dialect. She's got the cutest Austrian dialect. And she said to me the same thing that her sister said. And she said, Duke's gonna make it. She's like, it doesn't matter what it looks like at the moment. It doesn't matter how, what the doctors are saying. It doesn't matter what your worry is telling you. She says, Duke is a warrior. He's strong. Cats and dogs are strong. And she was really just pumping me with hope, pumping me with light, a positive outlook on the situation. And I stopped listening to the message when it was at its end. And then I saw her making another one. And then she said to me, no, really, Shelly. She's like, I know I'm just a kid. She's like, I know you think you're listening to this and you're thinking this is crazy, but I know. And I told their mother later, like the next day, I said, that really helped me. That 14-year-old and she and the other one just turned 18. I was like, they really helped me. And I started to think about what in the world do I think about this situation? Because so let's go back to the understanding, right? So principle of thought, I experience what I think in the moment, right? So I can think, so the doctors would call and say, it's not looking good. You might have to come in the next 2 hours, kind of whatever. And I would just sink into this feeling of grief and hopelessness, worry, fear, all the stuff. It would just pull me right down, right? And then I get these messages and they pulled me right back up in the other direction, right? And so I started to change my mind about how we can deal with the possibility of losing someone. So what I mean by that is before I would have said something like, I don't even know how to put it into words. Yeah, I would have taken the realist kind of lane, right? And then I realized somehow in that moment when I got those messages from the girls, why can't I take that road of hope? I can take that road of hope. I'm allowed to do that.
Totally.
It doesn't matter if it actually happens what the girls say or not. Of course, they don't have a crystal ball. Of course, they don't know how this is going to end. Of course, that's their, you know, their young naivety and their invincibility feeling. I remember that feeling at that age, right? And something in that allowance of hopefulness really did something positive for me in that situation. And it's starting to spread toward the situation with my husband's father, towards my father, towards the world at large, in a way, like, and all the stuff that's going on right now. So that's fresh for me, and I just wanted to share that with you.
Oh, I like that so much. Thank you, Shailia. What just comes to mind is sometimes we are so afraid in this community that to speak about positive thinking.
Yeah.
You know, but I'm totally into positive thinking. I'm totally into hope. Like, I heard it. It was not that he said it that way, but what I heard is that I can choose, and I do, because I'm so fed up, or I was, with my crazy thinking about whatever, that I didn't want to give this part any importance anymore. And I'm I know that I'm very strict about it, and in a way, you could see it as positive thinking because I just choose not to go with my low mood. I have it. It's not denying the feelings. It's not denying the angst or grief or hopelessness in moments, but I don't choose the path of I feel it, so it must be a fact. I just know that underneath it always points me back to health and hope. So I don't have to take any of my feelings as facts. So I rather be present and lighthearted as soon as possible than laying down with my crappy mood and feelings. And it's like knowing that my future self will be able to deal with whatever comes up, illness or death or all the balls that life just has to offer in this matter, form, space, time thing we are in. So I don't have to be realistic or worry or prepare. Sorry. Oh God,
There we go,
I'm
that word
going
again.
to be known for
Prepared.
prepared. I don't have to prepare myself that I'm. What I heard when you were speaking is your mind wanted to prepare you for the grief, and you don't have to be because you're going to be fine when it happens in the moment. So it's okay to feel it, but you don't have to stay there. And so to hope and to even feel lighthearted about it is doesn't make you weak or unprepared for whatever will happen. You know what I mean? That was a bit, sorry, I.
No, I do know what you mean. And what's coming to mean right now is it doesn't mean I'm lying to myself or others,
Yes. No.
right? Because I remember, so this is really an aha moment for me that I've had the last couple of weeks, because I remember, I think it was Michael Neal and his wife were dealing with some pretty heavy health issues that his wife was having. It may have been a cancer diagnosis. And I remember him talking in a blog article or one of his caffeine for the soul moments about he had a realization for himself that he didn't always have to be hopeful about the diagnosis, the opposite insight that I'm having at the moment, because he was constantly on the path to hope and kind of pushing himself to the path of hope and maybe lifting his wife up in a way by staying hopeful when he didn't always feel hopeful, right? And he was kind of scared to go the realist path for a little bit, like this could go the wrong way, right? This could be dicey on the journey, right? Kind of a thing. And I remember when I read that, thinking, because it was my old experience of life and illness and death, was, oh, good for him. He's seeing that it's not good to lie to yourself and others. This could also go out the wrong way, right? And there was something in there for me about not lying to yourself or others, right? And what I kind of saw recently was, well, if we anyway can't know, how the things are going to go, if we anyway know that in the moment we're going to be able to deal with the situation because we're made for that, well, why couldn't we choose the path of hope and have a better, more joyful experience? And when even just saying that to you, I feel it in my bones right now. It's like it really lifted me up. Yeah. And feeling too kind of like from that space, I'm more helpful. Right? I'm more helpful for me. I'm more helpful for my husband, who's also maybe scared and worried. I'm more helpful for Duke. I can make clear decisions for the family, whatever the thing is. And so there's something in there for me. Yeah, it's a shift. Yeah.
Ah, I love that so much. Also, the example with Michael, because you know, that's what I really, really like about this understanding, is it always reveals the thing for you
Yes.
to become more helpful.
Yes.
You know?
Yes.
And that's different for everyone, always. But to just becoming an expert in feeling where it points you towards your new seeing or insight, or where this that might be true could be for you.
Yes.
That's so cool, because the closer you get to that essence in you, the easier you navigate whatever comes up in your life. And that's so hopeful. That's hopeful for humanity for me. That's such a big word, but it's always there for us to see something new and different and more helpful for whatever is going on.
Yeah. And I love that, Leah. I love that because, I think sometimes, and that was where our story today started, right? We kind of get into sort of a rigidity of I've already gotten wisdom on this, right? Like I already know about this.
That's true. Oh.
And to realize, no, like we get wisdom in the moment for the moment, and then we get wisdom for the moment again, and we get wisdom for the moment in the moment again. And to recognize how alive that is, how ever-changing that is, how look in this situation, in this story, life showing the contrast of this way and that way. The realist and the optimist, like here is no hope, here's hope. And showing us like all of it in a way. That's so beautiful. That's so beautiful to me. Yeah.
And not being afraid of the human experience, probably that's again. We also want to use wisdom to not feel the human experience. And that's never possible. Never ever. And to let yourself step by step feel more of it, and being okay with whatever you experience is so helpful, because then it flows through you, and you're not try to it out of your system, or not having it, or thinking differently, or it's not there. It's never there. I love that. And our little head can't wrap itself around life or death. It's not possible. So we have to do it from another place somehow, and we just try so hard to do it from our little mind. And the clearer we get, the more helpful is little mind as well. That's also very interesting. As you said, then you know what to do. Then you know what's needed. Then you do the calls. Then you drive the car. And then it's helpful. It's so hopeful what you shared. And yeah.
So that feels good to me, Leah. Do you have anything else you want to say, or should we wrap it up for this one?
Wrap it up.
Let's wrap it up. So thanks for listening in, guys, taking some time for yourself. And we hope to hear, or you that you hear us. I hope we hear from you. You can write in the comments area of the podcast as well. Let us know what you're seeing for yourself, if you're enjoying the ride, what you'd like us to talk about, like whatever you want to share with us. And don't forget to subscribe to the podcast, share with your friends who might need this transformative conversation. And we'll see you on the next one.
Bye.
Bye.